Halloween is a really popular holiday that's as fun to create for as it is to celebrate. Today I'll show you how to create your own version of these Halloween-themed jars. A little paint, some ideology bits, and a little creativity are all you need to transform plain glass jars into these fun-themed decorations. This project began, of course, with these jars, and I knew immediately that I did not want to leave them clear. I wanted to go ahead and cover them up, and I've chosen black for that. You could do anything that you want. I'm using black distress paint because it's multi-surface, and that means it will work equally well on this glass as it will on paper. Having said that, these are the jars, and the thing that I would caution you is go ahead and wash the outside of this with some soap and warm water first. If there's any oils from your hand, if there's anything that's on there, you want to remove it so you're working on clean glass and you give the paint the best chance to adhere. Now, there are a couple options here. This one just has paint on it. You can see that there are these silvery drips, and we're going to talk about that. This one, on the other hand, has some of the Prima glass glitter on it. It's been painted, but I also used some of Ranger's texture paste on it, and I'm going to show you that only because the process of putting paint on a jar is almost as boring as watching paint dry. So let's start with this one, and you can see what I've done here. I have this one already begun. I put some texture paste on here earlier, and I've let it dry, so this is ready to go. I can paint over it. Now, in terms of how to do this, this is the Ranger texture paste. I'm going to put a little on, and then I'm just going to wipe it off, simply because, again, we don't need to wait for that to dry. All you do is you just take your texture paste and you kind of scooch it out there. You can make it in long drips. You can just make some loose mounds along the top. You can pretty much do whatever you want. It's not difficult at all. So I'm just going to wipe this off so that it's not getting in the way of going ahead and painting the jar. All right, so I've got texture paste on here. I previously washed this jar. Distress black soot paint. And this is a paintbrush that you can see the bristles are kind of splayed, but it's fine for these kinds of things. So I'm going to put some of the black distress paint, and I've already shaken this. I don't want to dump that mixing ball that's in there onto the craft sheet. I want to leave that inside. So I'm just going to go ahead and put some of the black paint out. And I'm actually going to paint everything with the black, including the texture paste. And then I'm going to come back and highlight it, and you'll see about that in just a couple of minutes. So this is not going to go on in one solid covering coat. You can see where it's a little bit streaky. I'm not worried about that at all. I just want to go ahead and get the black on here. I want to cover the texture paste, and then you're going to see I'm going to take a paper towel, and I'm just going to kind of pat the surface of the glass, which smooths the paint out a little bit. If you want absolutely opaque coverage, well, that wasn't nearly enough paint. If you want opaque coverage, you're going to have to go ahead and and put a couple of coats on here. Now, you can hasten the drying with your heated craft tool if you have one. If you want to just wait for it to air dry, of course, that's an option as well. That just takes a little bit too long for my taste. So, again, all I'm going to do is just go ahead and get a coat of paint on here. Same thing when I'm working with the ones that just have black paint on it. The only difference is I'm not painting over texture paste. Now, the only reason I'm actually going to do all of this right now is because I want to get this to the point where I can come back with the paper towel, show you what I do with it, and then we can move on. I want to show you a little bit about how I get that drippy silver look, and then we'll start to talk about embellishments, which are, of course, the most enjoyable part of this, because it allows you to take, and you can make your own, you can combine elements. I've used, as always, I'm a big fan of Tim's Ideology products. They're so easy to use. They're well made. I know that I can, when they come out of the package, they're going to be the same this time as they were the last time. So they're very dependable in terms of quality and consistency. All right, so I've got some black paint on here. Now, I do paint the bottoms. I just haven't here because generally I do it in two parts. I might get the sides done and then I would go back. And obviously I'm coming around to doing this rim too. And then I would go ahead and do the bottom. So I'm just going to take a piece of paper towel, and all I want to do is just start tapping. And you can see that's kind of taking the brush strokes out, and in some places it's kind of making this a little bit more transparent. This is a brand new bottle. of black soot paint, the distress paint, and so I think what's happened is maybe I didn't shake it enough, or it just could be because it hasn't evaporated a little bit, and so the color is a little bit less dense than it was in my original bottle. So what I'm gonna do, let me bring in the craft tool, let me dry this, I'll get another coat of paint on here, and then I'll come back and I'll show you tapping this off again so we get just a little bit more opaque coverage. This is a little bit more transparent than what I was trying for, so let me just do this and then I'll be back. All right, this is just about dry now, and so I'm gonna put it to one side to let it finish air drying, and we'll come back and we'll talk about the glass glitter in a second. But let me bring this one back in for now and we'll talk about this dripping thing that's going on here. And I have another jar that's just had some of the black paint put on. Now the one thing that I will tell you is you're not gonna get perfect coverage. This is again one of those imperfectly perfect things. And in some places you're gonna have paint that's a little bit heavier than others. Mostly I'm just trying for a really flat finish that doesn't have any gloss on it other than what's going to happen with this silver. And so my silver of choice, this is just the De La Rowney F&W Pearlescent Ink, and this was really very straightforward. You're just going to go ahead and shake it to make certain that you've distributed all the pigment in there, and then it's just a question of squirting this around the neck of the jar and letting it drip. Now, if you want to encourage the drips a little bit more, what you can do is take your spray bottle with water and just go ahead and thin that a little bit, and that will help the color spread and run a little bit. How much dripping you have is, of course, entirely up to you. You can force that, you can put more on there so you get more drips. Really, it's entirely a matter of preference. I did miss right there, so I'm just going to put a little bit more on. And then, of course, it's just a question of putting this to one side and letting it dry. Now, I probably hurried this along at some point with a little bit of warmth from the heat tool, so you can do that if you want. But while this is drying, what I do want to do, and I'm making a merry mess here, what I do want to do is let me just put this off camera and go ahead and swab this area down a little bit, and let me bring in, whoops, not what I want, let me bring in the jar with the texture paste on it. Again, for the silver that I put on here, and do you have to do this? Not necessarily, because the glass glitter does actually cover quite a lot. The texture paste provides a little bit of a raised element, and then I went over that with the glass glitter. But you can see, like here, there's a little bit of silver. That's not glitter. That's the F&W Pearlescent Ink. So let me show you how I did that. Again, I'm just going to put a little tiny bit out here, and I would caution you, if you have Inca Gold, silver Inca Gold, you could use that too. The technique is a little bit more precise, in as much as this can be precise. What I'm trying to do is dry brush with my finger. So all I want to do is put just the littlest bit on there of the F&W Pearlescent, and then I want to tap most of it off. And then I'm just going to come in, and I'm going to highlight the raised areas of the texture paste. Now, if you choose not to go ahead and use the glass glitter, you could just leave it like this. I, as you know, love glitter, so for me this is kind of a fun process, and I was really anxious to try the new glass glitter anyway. Obviously Prima has it, and Stampendous has new glass glitter, and I thought this was kind of a fun way to get in and play with that. So I pretty much did this all the way around, again just doing this very lightly so that I hit mostly just the raised areas, although you can see that there are some lower areas that I am catching too. And you could certainly do this with any kind of metallic paint. Doesn't have to be the F&W Pearlescent, but they are such a permanent part of how I work that they are on my work table all of the time, so they're there. I don't have to go searching for anything else. So that's that. Let me just go ahead and wipe this up. And then what I did, this is the color Platinum in the Prima Glass Glitter. You can see that it actually, maybe what it looks like on camera for you, I can't exactly tell, but for me it has almost a little bit of a bluish cast, but I think it works just fine in this situation. I think it looks kind of like aged, which is fine with me too. So again, my trusty Aileen's Thick Designer Tacky Glue, the reason I like this is because it works on all kinds of surfaces, and that means whether I'm working on something porous like the texture paste, and technically not totally porous because it's got distress paint on it, or I'm working right on the glass, I can go ahead and use the texture paste. Now the one thing I neglected to do was grab a piece of paper. I'm going to want something that I can catch the glass glitter with. So all I'm going to do is just come in and apply the adhesive wherever I want the glass glitter to be. Now it doesn't have to be only on the texture paste, it can pretty much be anywhere I want. And you'll notice here that I actually included some right at the neck of the jar, and even though there's no texture paste there, it just kind of clings in there if you put the alienes in there. So, you know, you can kind of do this however you want. This is your place to exercise a little bit of artistic license. You can add as much or as little of the glitter as you want. So I did this in parts. I probably did this in thirds, and I've got enough on there for now, so I'm just going to bring in that scratch paper I mentioned and the glass glitter. And you can kind of dump this, but it ends up going all over the place, so I actually like to do it like this with my fingers. And I do end up getting glue on my fingers and having the glass glitter stick, but this kind of is the best way, at least that's what I've discovered. And I just go ahead and I touch the glitter to where the glue is, and it adheres. Now you have to do this reasonably quickly. You don't want the adhesive to start to skin over in the way that it will as it starts to dry. So you don't want to dawdle. You just want to kind of get in there and get the glitter in place. And that's why I did this in sections rather than all at once. Now again, I'm going to knock all the excess off. And when I turn this around, you can see that I've got my glitter going here. As much, as little as you like. Get your jars ready, and I recommend that you put the texture paste on first. And what I did deliberately was I put a strip. This is from the laboratory tissue tape collection, and I put this around the bottom. Nothing says you can't put decorations on your jar first and then put texture paste over the top. This just happens to be the way that I worked. Either one works. Whatever you want to do is fine. But I wanted to get my jars all prepared, whether it was with the texture paste or it was with the silver on top once I had the black all ready to go. And then it's time to start thinking about embellishments. I'm going to show you how to make lots of different embellishments. There's a variety of things that you can do here. We have these little glass vials. We have these wonderful crossbones, or not crossbones, I think that's what they're called. They're one of the adornments from the Audiology line. And there's just all kinds of things. We're going to use the laboratory paper stash. That's where this skeleton came from. It's where this strip of paper here came from. So I'm going to show you all of those things, just really fun ways to make these into a really interesting Halloween decoration. Because I'm not a collector of ephemera and all kinds of other paper things, I have to find an alternate means of having imagery for my projects. And oftentimes I turn to one of Tim Holtz's paper stashes, and for this project, I've actually chosen the laboratory stash. So let me just show you a little bit about them. Like all the paper stashes, there are full-size 12 by 12 images. You can see that this is the periodic table of elements. And then they have been reduced to something else. For example, let's see, some of them are reduced to 6x6 sizes, and you'll have four of these on a page. Some of them have been reduced. This is unusual, at least this seems to be particular to the laboratory stash. You get these long lengths of imagery here, which actually have come in quite handy. But there's all different kinds of things going on. Again, some of those long lengths, and some of these other things where they've been reduced to ATC size, which is what you see here. And some of these are some really fun kind of, you know, ads that are particular to the Halloween theme of this pad as well as our project and work really well. So there's all different kinds of things in this pad, from images of people to these advertisements and, you know, things like the table of elements. So what I chose to do was to take advantage of some of these sheets that have these long lengths. These end up being 12 inches long. I took advantage of some of those. That's what you see here on this one that says poison, and then you'll notice it wraps around and then it finishes with something that's actually different. The reason is because at 12 by 12, one 12 inch strip of this is not enough to fit around the circumference of this jar. But that's okay, there's always ways to make it work. So what I did was I took these over to my my cutting mat, my rotary cutter, and my ruler, and I just went ahead and I sliced this off. So I have this length here that's 12 inches. So let me move that out of the way, and move this stuff out of the way, and show you where I'm going next. And I am going to bring in some of these other pieces, but let's get to the beginning, or let's start at the beginning first, before we overcomplicate things. So I know that I want this to be one of the main elements on this piece, or on this jar. Now, I can adjust this so that I can have words fall in certain places if I want to, like this. But then I'm going to be left with a join here where I've got to put something else in, and maybe not the most elegant. So what I might do instead, now interestingly enough, on the back of this is this really cool ruler that it says American Type Founders, Branches and Selling Agents in 28 Cities. So this is just a ruler. It's not anything that's necessarily Halloween or holiday oriented, but I can use this because it's got this chemical laboratory thing on it. So what I would probably do, let me just turn this around to the back, would be to go ahead and put this on here and adjust it so that I end up with a reasonably even amount on either side, which this actually isn't. I'd have to play with this for a moment. And then I would go ahead and glue this in place using the Aliens the Thick Designer Tacky Glue. And then I would find, like I did here, whoops, where are we? Like I did here, I would find one of these advertisements that would span the difference between the two of them. And then you can see that I went ahead and I used tissue tape. Now, in the laboratory tissue tape collection, there are three sizes and three prints on there. So you have a ruler, you have this kind of chevron-y pattern, and again, this is strips of elements from the periodic table. And I've actually used both of these. So let me take a second and go ahead and get this in place. And what I'm going to do, I just want to look at this from the back. First of all, I'm not certain if I want to put this at the bottom, in the middle, at the top. I actually haven't made up my mind yet. But the thing that I really want to do is get this on here and kind of get the bends in place that will be the edges of the jar in such a way that I have roughly, well, of course it went ahead and moved, I will have roughly the space in the back that's equidistant here. So I think for this one, as I look at this, I think what I'm going to do is go ahead and place this more along the bottom. I've got one at the top here. This one has tissue tape along the bottom because obviously I would be competing with the texture paste and the glitter, so I left that along the bottom. So let me just take one second. I'm going to come back to my tacky glue, and then I'm just going to go ahead. Now, I don't worry about getting this down there exactly. I don't care if there's a little bit of lift along the edges. Mostly I just want to get this in place, and then I'm going to cover the edges with the tissue tape, so it'll be fine. Now, I thought about using score tape for this. The thing with score tape is that you get one chance to put it in place exactly where you want it. And if you miss, there's really no adjusting it. And I knew that I was going to have to do some adjustment with this, so I decided the best thing to do would be to use the tacky glue because it would allow me some flexibility to make those adjustments. So I'm just trying to sort of scrape a thin layer on here. Clean this up. And now what I'm going to do is start to get this on the bottom. So I can kind of see where there's a bend from the last time I played with this, and I actually got pretty lucky. I got it on there pretty close. So what I'm going to do is just go ahead, and if I need to, I can grab a ruler and I can kind of check the distance here, but again, that would, you know, that's really probably more aggravation than you need to go through. All I want to do is make certain that this is on here pretty darn close. I'm not worried about it being perfect, but once this is on here, now I have the beginnings of a really cool embellished jar. So what I will do, now I need to find from all of these bits and pieces. I said these parts of the images were made into the ATC size. There are some smaller ones here. For example, I could cut this right here, this tincture of iodine. I could cut that out if I could put my hands on some scissors. Okay. Ordinarily, I would do this with a rotary cutter, but for the sake of argument here, I'm just going to go ahead and cut this skeleton off. And now I can just cut this piece off. Trying to say as straight as possible. And then all I need to do is just come in here. Oops, that's not as straight as I thought. I'm going to want to fix that right quick. There, that's better. Okay, so now what I'll do is I'll take some of the adhesive, go ahead and put it on the back. And as you can see, all of these papers are double-sided. So if there's an element on the back that you like instead, more is the better. You have lots of opportunities. This pad is full of really fun Halloween themed kind of, you know, spooky elements. So, I could just pick this up now. All I need to do is go ahead and put this in place. I just want it to be kind of on there. I'm deliberately not lining the edge of this filler piece with the paper. I think it looks kind of interesting the way it is. Now, I just want to come around here and make certain that I don't have any gaps or I don't have any wrinkles in that original strip of paper, and I don't. So what I'll do now, I don't think I want to use this because my paper is light and I don't think there's enough contrast. And I'm not sure I want to use this because it's dark, but let's see how that looks, because I've already used the narrow one once, so I'd kind of like to use something else. I'm going to trim this. Now on my original prototype, if you look at the back here, you can see that I actually put the tissue tape on before I put this back piece on. Since I've done this a little bit out of order, what I need to do now is accommodate the edge of this piece here. So I'm just going to trim the tissue tape so that it's kind of even. And I am going to allow this to overlap. It's probably a good eighth of an inch overlap here. Now, because of the shape of the corners on these, they're not straight. There will be just the tiniest bit of wrinkling as you make the tissue tape go around the corners, but you can just kind of ease it in place. It's not that big a deal. That looks pretty good. That looks pretty good. So all I'm going to do now is come back and I'm going to cut this so I know it's going to line up with the edge of that piece, and I'm basically good to go. Now along the bottom, maybe what I'll do is I'll come back with the narrow tissue tape just to give it a little bit of a finished edge, but not as wide as this piece here. And then from here, now again, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, there's lots of different ways to make embellishments. This is one of the images from probably one of the 6x6 pieces from the laboratory pad. This is one of the plaquettes, obviously 31 for Halloween. I colored some rayon seam binding with black soot distress spray stain. Lots of different things. A vial that's got some glass glitter in it. What else do I have here? We're going to talk a little bit about, Tim has a set of stamps that I can't think of what it's called, but it has some really fun Halloween type images. And what I did was I have these small tags. They're all craft and they come in a variety of sizes. And I did a little bit of, I hate when the word won't come. I did a little bit of embossing with embossing powder and that image. And in addition to that, you can use some of the images to just go ahead and stamp on the tag. And then these rub-ons here are from the, I want to say that this is laboratory. It's the apothecary remnant rubs. Now, black as always, but you also have, let's see if I can tip that. You also have all of the same images in white, and since we're working on a black background jar, that means that you could put some of these remnant rubs right on the jar if you wanted to. So that's what's going to be next. We're even going to do something fun with these little bird cages. I'm going to show you, whoops, how you can use a remnant rub. Just go ahead and put it on a piece of one of these tags, cut it out to fit, and then you can hang that off of here. We're going to talk about various ways to hang elements, and then eventually we'll get to the lids of these, because these come with, this is the lid. Now I've deliberately just given this a very light coat of black paint. I'm not even going to bother with the inside because unless somebody takes the lid off the jar, they're not going to see it anyway. So these lids fit on here like this. Now you can go ahead and cut something out and put it on here. I could put some glitter on here. There's a variety of different things that I could do with Ideology embellishments. But the other thing that I'm going to show you how to do is to take some wooden discs. These are just circular pieces of pre-cut wood. I think I have them from 1.5 inches up to 3 inches. And I'm going to show you how you can stack them together and make some really cool tops that can sit on this lid. Starting with some of the more simple embellishments are this adornment. These are just crossbones, and they're perfect for a Halloween-themed project like this. I like to go ahead and adhere them with the Aliens, the super thick tacky glue. you can pretty much put them anywhere you want. So because the back of these, the head especially, is very open and hollow, I try to use a glue that's going to have some really good staying power. And so what I like to do is just kind of fill this in a little bit. And then obviously I want to get adhesive on the flat parts so that they stick where they're, where I'm going to put them. And then it's just a question of, let's see, where shall I put this? How about right here? It's just a question of going ahead and putting that in place. Now there's a little bit of adhesive that's kind of crept out, and just bear with me one second. I need to reach for a clean toothpick. One of the things that I like to do, you see the adhesive right in there? It's really easy to take that out by just coming in and using your toothpick and lifting it out. And of course this is always going to dry clear, so there'll be very little evidence that there was some glue where you kind of didn't really want it. But these are super simple. Also falling into the super simple category are the plaquettes. Now there's, I want to say, 6 or 9 of them in a the package. 31 is in there, 25 is in there, so obviously those are great for Christmas. And then there's just some anonymous other numbers in there. So all I did was take some Rand seam binding and the Black Soot Distress Spray Stain, and I spritzed some on here. I didn't end up wanting it to all look like this, with it just being saturated with black. What I was trying for was to get some areas like this where it was just kind of variegated. And I have that look here. This isn't solid black, so that's fine. And then it's going to be the same process. Some of the super thick tacky glue on the back, and then you would adhere it wherever you want. Haven't actually made my mind up about that, but it's an option. Let's talk now for a moment about this bird cage, which is actually pretty straightforward too. They come like this from the package, and inside the package is this little template that you can use to cut the piece out that goes against the back. But before you can do that, and I didn't think to grab a pair of pliers, so you can do that with your fingers, although it's far easier to close them if you have a couple of pairs of pliers. Just going to spread on the jump ring, you're just going to open that up. A little bit more than that. There we go. Take it out, and then that's going to allow the back to become separated from the front. Now you can do this one of two ways. You can either use a pencil, if I could put my fingers on one, you could use a pencil and trace around this piece, or you could cut the template out from the package back and you could trace around that. I'm just going to use one of these small tags, and I'm going to take advantage of the fact that the sides are already pre-cut, and that's a 90 degree angle, and so I'm just trying to line this up so I can see what I'm doing here. This will just be a little bit less that I have to cut. So I'll come and trace this like this. Then it's just a matter of using my scissors and cutting it out really carefully. Obviously I want this to, I'm trying to be really careful when I cut, and talking doesn't always go with that. I want to be really careful how I cut this out so that I don't see any gaps of the metal behind this. And if I need to fine-tune this, I can. But as I lay this on here, oops, this seems pretty darn good. I might narrow the side just a tiny little bit if I think that it's a little bit too big. Again, the fine-tuning you kind of do as you're going along. Now, what to put on here? Well, pretty much anything you want. You could adhere something on here. I have the Apothecary Remnant Rubs. As I said earlier, there's this white version, and then the black version is identical. Now, on my original sample, you can just see a silhouette and profile, so I'm going to use the other silhouette. It actually works out pretty well size-wise for this particular embellishment. So it's just a matter of getting that on there where I think it goes. Now, if I wanted to move this down, I could, but what I'm going to do is kind of cheat this toward the top a little bit, trying to make sure that that's reasonably straight, which I can see it's not. So again, I'm just going to mess with this the tiniest bit to get that on there straight. They come with this popsicle stick thingy. All you're going to do is just use it and rub the rub-on in place. And you can kind of see the surface change as the rub-on itself begins to adhere to whatever it is you're putting it on. And that's going to be your guide. That's kind of what you're looking for. And then you can just start very tentatively peeling that acetate piece off. and then making certain that you're leaving the rub-on behind. Now, there are image elements in this set, this apothecary set, and there are also some words. So, what you might notice here is the word wicked. If I turn that so that you can see it. The remnant rubs will stick. They adhere to the metal. I don't see any difficulty with that as I've played with it. So what you can do, let's see, I'm just trying to find a single word that's small enough. Let's go with spooky. So I'm just going to cut in here. When I do this, I try to cut as closely to the letters as possible so that I'm not fighting all that extra acetate. Also trying to make certain that it doesn't stick to my fingers and that rub-on doesn't actually end up coming off on my fingers. This is where tweezers come in really handy, except that I was using mine, and here they are, as I say, and I didn't put them back where they belong. So let me get this out of the way. Now, I'm going to grab the rub-on with the tweezer, and I know that this bar in the cage right here is pretty much the center. So I'm going to line this happens to be a word with an odd number of letters. Oh no, it doesn't. It has an even number of letters. I can't count today. So I'm going to kind of center this so that the two middle letters are pretty much just over that center bar or aligned with that center bar. And for this, I was going to try to use my fingernail just because it's a little awkward. But I need to get this started. Sometimes I find that the edge of the tweezer works pretty well, too, to go ahead and get that remnant rub actually down on the surface. And once you get it started like that, then it's not so difficult and it doesn't want to move all over the place on you. Again, I'm going to lift that very carefully, and then I'm just going to use my fingers and make certain that the remnant rub is in place. Now the K is just overhanging a little bit, but that's not a problem at all. I can do the same thing here. I can take a word or a pair of words from the apothecary remnant rub or rub-on set, and I can put that here. And then it's just a question of adhering this in place, putting this back together till the back is in place, and then you use the jump ring to put it all back together so it looks like it did originally. So that's that. There are just tons of different things that you can do to make your embellishments. These are, what are these called? Vials. And you can see that there's a little cork in there, and it's just an empty, tiny little glass jar. And the assortment comes with different sizes. Some of them are longer, some of them are bigger, but for the purposes of this project, I like that size. Now, what can you put in there? I'm going to put some of this. This is the Prima Art Ingredient Glass Glitter. I believe this is called copper. Again, this is kind of in keeping with my Halloween theme, so I'm just going to use a palette knife, and I'm going to scoop a little bit out on the palette knife, and then just go ahead and put it in the vial. Now, there are also vial labels. If you want to put them on here, you can, but the thing with the vial labels is that they also make really cool embellishments on their own. You can use the remnant rubs, and you can put some words on them, and then you can adhere them to the project. Now, obviously, it's going to take a moment to go ahead and fill that up. You don't need to see me on camera fill that all up, but that's another thing that you can do. So let me just kind of clear this out of the way and bring in some other things. Monocles. These are one of my favorite ideology products, and these are, let me think what these are called, enamel tags. Really cool. Again, black and white, you really can't go wrong. Same process. I'm going to choose a remnant rub that fits on that tag. I'm going to cut it out. Put it in place. Get it centered on there. And then it's going to be the same process. You don't need to see me adhere that. It's the exact same way. And I would do the same thing with a monocle. Now, as the monocles come from their little package, and of course I had one here. Here it is. There actually is a front and a back. Although at the end of the day, does it matter? Not really. What I did was, again, I took a remnant rub. This time, let's use a white one, because I'm sure that this will work just fine, too. Someplace here. I thought I had a white remnant rub ready to go. But what we will do instead, where did that skull go? I wanted to reuse that skull. Well, it's buried. So let's go ahead and we'll use this. the point that I'm desperately trying to make is that with the remnant rub, you can use white on the monocle or you can use black. And then for that matter, if you want to mix them, you can do that too. So I can go ahead and let's just put this remnant rub on there. I can go ahead and get this remnant rub on in white, and then I can use some of the black words if I want to create this really fun embellishment. I am so fond of these monocles. I think they're such a great product. One of the things that I always say is this had come from the package, so I know it's clean. I didn't actually stop to clean it. But one of the things I always like to say is make certain that the monocle is clean before you do whatever you're going to do to it, because otherwise you will fight that smudge or whatever it is forever. You really, once you put a rub on, you're not going to be able to get the smudge or the smear off. So, and of course this is being difficult, so I'm not going to actually finish that, but what you can do then is take a word, as I've done here, and just go ahead and put it on the bottom. So those are the enamel tags, and we have the monocles. Let's come back, to these little craft tags for a second. This set of stamps is called Mini Halloween, and this is a group of all these really, all these really fun Halloween elements that have been shrunken, sort of like a shrunken head, but have been shrunken to fit all these other small things. So what I did, again, black stays on, it is my thing of choice. All you're gonna do is just ink this up. Go ahead and stamp it. Now, because this doesn't take up the entire tag, I can come back again with remnant rubs. I could put them on here. The other thing that I like to do, again, I want to keep this all aged and kind of looking the same, would be to grab my Distress Ink and my Mini Ink Blending Tool, which is here someplace. And I've done this, you can see I've done this with all of the tags. So this one is going to be fairly dark. Some of them are a little bit lighter. You can do whatever you want. I like to do this before I put the remnant rubs on. I just do. That's the way I've been doing it. And this, very interestingly, is again from this set. It's this really fun owl here. And all I did was go ahead and emboss it with black embossing powder. And then I came around and I aged the edge with some black, as I did a second ago. And I went ahead and put a word from the remnant rubs on there. This is a hinge clip. They come from the package. There is one here somewhere because I got it out. They come from the package looking like this, and they clip like this. Now I have taken this. This is some of the ball chain, and it comes with these little doohickeys like you would see on an old-fashioned light chain. They come with these little doohickeys so that you can fasten a length of the chain end to end. All you have to do is cut it with some wire cutters to whatever length you need, and then go ahead and use this to attach it. Now, we have all of these really fun elements, and then the question becomes, well, all right, if we're not going to adhere it to the jar itself, how are we going to go ahead and attach them on there? And toward that end, I have some of the jute, which is colors, and I'm going to choose the black, and I have the linen, what is this called? The linen ribbon. This is it right here. I need to get this out of the package, but there's a variety of ways that we can do this, and by utilizing all of these jump rings, we can hang all of this stuff off of the jars. So that's what I'm going to do next. I'm going to finish up all of these little elements, and then we'll start adding them to the jars. Oh, and before I forget, the white remnant rubs, where's my little doohickey, look really great on these jars. Obviously, the black ones are not going to work, but the white ones stand out perfectly well against that black paint that we put on there. So you can take and apply these directly to your jars if you want. And it's just another way to add some interest and some patterning. Well, I screwed that up, but I won't tell if you don't. It's just another way to add some interest and some patterning and texture to your jars. Let's finish our Halloween jars projects by talking about the various elements that I've attached to them, but more specifically, let's start with these elements that are wrapped around the neck of the jars. I have several different options. First, we have some rayon seam binding. This is what was left over from the plaquette here. You remember I talked about this earlier. You just hit it with something black to color it, and I didn't want to make it fully black. I liked the variation. This is linen ribbon. let's just slide this in. This is some of the black jute string, which is a little hard to see, but here's an end right here. This is basically what this is. It's just plain old jute string, and it comes in a package with black, natural, and a bunch of other colors. And then, whoops, this is ball chain. So I'm going to talk about all of these options, but let's start with the ball chain. Let me just slide these out of the way. So the chain comes out of the package. I want to say it's each color is maybe 36 inches long, and there's quite a lot of it. I've already used some here, and I've used it in other projects. So I had enough of this copper color version to go ahead and wrap this around the neck of the jar twice. Obviously, what I have left here of this won't do it, but it's actually very straightforward. They come with this, like I showed you before, this is just this little clasp that you put the two ends together with. You slide the ball in there and snap it into place. Now, what I did initially to make attaching my embellishments a little bit easier, I cut this initially longer than I wanted it to be so that there was enough slack that I could easily get in here with the jump rings and other things to attach. And then once that was through, I came back and I shortened it. So it worked a little bit better. And trimming this is really easy. Trimming it to length, you just use some wire snips like this. Go ahead and place it on the metal that's between the two balls, and you just cut it to whatever length you need it to be. Now, when we talk about the rayon seam binding, same thing. This is actually on here with a little bit more slack than I would ordinarily leave, but this is a square knot. It will be really easy to take out. But again, the slack is easier when it comes time to go ahead and attach these various elements. When we talk about the linen ribbon, let me turn this around. First of all, I like to fray the edges. I think that kind of helps give it this old, spooky look. The one thing that I did do, this is how it comes from the package. I came in with my black soot distress ink and my mini ink blending tool, and I actually wanted to dirty this a little bit. I felt that it was a little bit too bright looking, so I came in and just did this. Now, there are going to be creases from where this is wrapped around the card. Once you go ahead and color this, you can just mist it a little bit, and it does affect the color a little tiny bit, but not enough to be a problem. And then that ends up taking those hard bends from the packaging out of there. This is the jute that I mentioned, as I said, lots of different colors. So the last piece left now is the jute itself. And again, I did the same thing. I've got a little bit of length here that I can trim off, but I did leave this loose to begin with. It's really hard if you've got this up tight to actually go ahead and do anything. So let me show you, once there's enough slack, how simple that is. This is another one of the tags that I made. This is the stamp from the mini Halloween set we talked about earlier. Both of these are, and a remnant rub. And this is one of the jump rings. Now, they come in a package like this with the standard three colors, and they come in two sizes. I'm finding the larger ones easy to use, and I will be honest, I'm not using pliers to open and close the jump rings. I find that's a little bit too fiddly for me. It's been easier to just go ahead and do it this way. So I think I'm going to add this, let's see, let me add this to the jar that has the seam binding. All I did was very straightforward. They come closed like this, so all I did was bend it to open it, slip it through the hole in the tag, and then making certain that it's facing the right way, you're just going to come in, attach it to whatever it is that's around the neck of the jar, and then go ahead and close it. And so you've got this. Now, all of these other elements that you saw me make earlier have been attached, most of them with jump rings, but some of them, remember I talked about this earlier, I had a short length of the chain, and I used that to attach it just to kind of give it a different look. Now, one of the things that I didn't show you earlier that I wanted to mention now is this skeleton that's cut from one of the pieces of paper on the laboratory paper pad. Cut out elements that you think are interesting and then layer them with crossbones. You can do all different kinds of things with them. You don't have to just embellish the neck of the jar and have things hanging off it. There's lots of ways to go ahead and add interesting elements right to the jar themselves. I mean, we talked about the tissue tape, but there's plenty of other things we can do. As I said earlier, I'm really fond of the monocles. I like the way that looks. The birdcage looks really fun here too. So lots of different things that you can do. And I would encourage you to try your hand at all of them. The one thing that I did want to show you, and let me see if I can find the jar. All right, so here's the one that I'm looking at. Remember earlier, we filled the little glass vial with some of the glass glitter. This is the copper color Prima Glass glitter. Now, what I didn't mention earlier was I put just the littlest, tiniest bit of the tacky glue on here and pushed the cork in here so that this couldn't come open by mistake and there wouldn't be glass glitter all over the place. And as far as attaching it, I've done that here by using a piece of the jute, and you can see that there's a little indent on this neck of the bottle right here, or the vial, so the jute fits in there quite nicely. Or if you want to, you can use the rayon seam binding. Same thing, it will fit in there quite nicely. And all you have to do is tie the seam binding or the jute directly to the vial, and then go ahead and just make a loop and attach the vial to whatever it is that's around the neck. Lots of different ways to do this. I have to tell you, I'm really, really pleased with these. I wasn't certain I was going to have time to finish all four, but in the process of prepping everything for the video, I did, and I'm really pleased that I did. So let me, here they are, and as I said, I'm really happy. So let's just slide this one back into the shop for a moment. And you can see that the lid on this is very different than the other lids. This is the standard lid that comes with the jar, and as I said earlier, I'm too lazy to even paint the inside. I can't be bothered because nobody's going to see it. So all I did was just slap one thin coat of paint on there, and I left some of the wood showing through. I don't have a problem with that at all. Then what I did was I thought, well, this is kind of flat. So the first thing I did was play with, this is an ornate plate, and these are various elements that come from the paper pad. And again, they're always sized differently depending on, this is an ATC size, this is just another element from there, and I thought what I would do would be to cut out a piece of paper to fit in here, one of these designs, and I thought that I would use, again, in keeping with the skeleton theme, which is here, I thought it would be fun to pick up the skeleton and maybe put it on here, on this one right here, or I could use this part of the skeleton here, which is a little bit bigger, and so you see more of the skull. Lots of different options, but then what I would do would be someplace here, when you buy these, the ornate plates come with these little brads. This is how you would ordinarily hold them in place. But since I'm not going to use the brads as a means of attachment, I do want to at least use them to fill the holes that are put in the plates when they're manufactured. So all I would do would be to open the legs on the brad like this, and then I would use some glue to hold them in place, and that way the top of the plate looks a little bit finished. You don't see that hole there. And then depending on what I chose to put on here, I would end up with a flat piece like this. But at least it's not boring and it's not empty, and they don't all have to look the same, and I kinda like this look. So this is what I might do here. But now let's talk about the one with this more elaborate top. Companies make these various wood elements available. These are discs, and we'll have these available for sale on the website. These are discs ranging in diameter from 1.5 inches all the way up to 3 inches. And what I did for this top right here was I took 2 of the 3-inch ones and I stacked them together and I glued them. It's really easy to do. Let me just grab the tacky glue and a toothpick. I don't use a lot of glue because if you use a ton, it's going to mean that these won't sit together really tightly. So the first thing I do is go ahead and sand them to just take the rough edges off. These are mass-produced outside of the country, probably in China, and they are not perfectly smooth. I mean, most wooden things that you buy are not perfectly smooth. They're going to require some sanding. So I want to just scrape on a little bit, a thin layer of adhesive like this, so that I know that these guys are going to be held together really well, but I'm not putting so much on that I'm going to make this have a big gap in between. So then you line them up, you press it really good, and then you're going to do the same thing. As I said, these vary in diameter from 3 inches to 1.5 inches, and then they have these really cool, this is supposed to be, I think, a doll head. It's got this hole in the bottom, and it's flat, which means it sits flat, which means you can then stack this up like this. So you can get some elevation on your lids with very little effort at all. What I did was sand the pieces. I tested them to see how I wanted this to be. I glued all of the elements together, then I painted it, and then I just simply glued this unit to the top of the lid. And it's really that simple. You can do this. You can leave your lids totally alone and not do anything to them other than maybe some paint, or you can put something flat on there like this. It really is entirely up to you. These are really easy and fun projects for Halloween decorating. The thing that I enjoyed the most was creating all of the embellishments. This is an arrow adornment, again, stamps. Now the one thing that I did do that I haven't done here yet, and I'll take it off and do it, I just used a Pitt pen and outlined the tag. I thought it gave it a little bit more interesting, more finished look, and I do prefer that over when you see this here without the border on it. So again, that's up to you. But there just are so many different ways, whether you emboss or you just stamp, whether you add glitter or you don't, there's just a myriad of ways to finish these and make these totally unique to you and your Halloween celebration. I hope that you have as much fun making them as I did.